Bienvenue au jour 3 de Data Ecoculture qui...
Welcome to day 3 of Data and Ecoculture, which gathers us around innovative practices around data. So you have interpretation. You can select the language of your choice by clicking for this option at the bottom of your screen. It will be recorded. And if you do not wish to appear, please off your camera. I'm Louise Poisson, Scientific Director of the Fund's Society and Culture of the Quebec Research Fund. While we are meeting ourselves on a virtual platform, I would like to take a moment to indicate the importance. So from one ocean to another in Canada, we recognize all of the members of the First Nation, Inuit and Métis. So please join yourself to me to recognize their value, perspective, language, and culture, which could very well inspire us. I have the honor to introduce to you our first guest, Delegate Minister René Kerr of the Digital Innovation. Eric Kerr started in politics more than 14 years ago. In 2011, they joined the ranks of Coalition Québec, and he's deputy minister and father of four, is passionate of computer sciences, and since 2018 is a minister responsible to the access to information and the protection of private information. So, Mr. Minister, I invite you to address to us. Thank you very much, Mrs. Poisson, for this wonderful introduction, and thank you for this wonderful invitation to this extremely important event as a data eco-culture. To start off, I would like to talk to you about digital transformation. First and foremost, it is a societal phenomenon. Nowadays, we realize that the younger generation is more able and consumer of digital products, and we are all more able to use all of those tools, just as smartphones. You said it, Mrs. Poisson, that I'm a father of four, and you know, I wasn't under the impression that they were born with a telephone, and when you're removing that smartphone from a child, it's like cutting off an arm. So in our society, we're going through, whether we like it or not, this digital transformation. This is no choice. It is a societal transformation. This being said, it's not because we have the choice and know that we cannot draw profit from it. And in that sense, I salute the initiative of the project Synapse C to have this warehouse of data and sharing of data that is going to continue in the years to come. And I'd like to greet the partners that accepted to embark into this fabulous project. Why? Because digital transformation and digital universe, as we must see it as being such, often I tell my colleagues, do not see computer science as it used to be, a support that allows us to do better and faster what we've always done. The digital universe is a universe as such in which we must integrate ourselves and we must be part of it. So it is a philosophy that's completely different, possibilities that are completely distinct. And the management and sharing of data is the foundation of that universe. It is absolutely essential and fundamental that these data be mobile and shared. The government of Quebec will have a bylaw that will be filed in, and we want to value data. We repeat it over and over again. This is the fuel of the future, actually. So this is what the project of Synapse C is bringing to the universe of culture. Well, Well, for the universe of culture, and the pandemic gave us an important example, is a universe that must also review its way of doing things, its concepts, review the integration of digital and digital all together, because it's not only a broadcasting platform, you know, where you need some special effect. The digital world is a possibility to have a customer experience that is completely revamped and different. I often give an example as a hockey fan, and I confess this, you know, with all the modesty required, you know, the way all of the games are broadcasted and give us a completely different experience than the show. You know, it's the same show, you know, whether we're sitting at home or at the Bell Center, but the experience is completely different. This brings me to say that it doesn't mean that the scene experience no longer exists, or the experience with the public does not exist. It will always be the heart and soul of the cultural side, and it puts a human being in all of its splendor and possibility. Exponentially, we can reach the public whom we want to turn to, and we can review the cultural product altogether. So all of this is available through data, yes, that allows you to proceed with analysis, cross analysis, who's the target audience, who's interested in such and such other cultural product. And this is very important, but data can offer you much more than that in your experience, design, creativity, and the production of cultural product, discovery of cultural products. So there's no boundaries in digital, so the cultural product will no longer have any boundaries either if we decide to go ahead with this. So this is a nice progression over which we can build extraordinary things. But once again, I must tell you, the foundation of all of that is the data, mobility of data and sharing of data that we accept to do. And the more we share it, the more we use it, the more we refine it, and the more it will allow us to go far in this universe. So I'm open for questions. So thank you very much, Mr. Minister, for this brief presentation. I do understand that there were so many more things to say. Well, I attempted to discipline myself. Well, you succeeded in doing so. So a very good idea regarding the importance that you give to this area and the impulse that you'd like to give us. And I'm very happy to hear that you will file a bylaw in that regard. So I have a question. In your strategy 2019-2023, there is a question on laws and regulations. We know that the discoverability of the Quebec content has a challenge on the digital platforms. Do you want to join efforts with the federal government and other countries, like France, amongst others, to review the regulations and develop actions in order to ease the access to the Quebec access and Canadian also? Well, in collaboration with my colleague, the Culture and Communication Minister, whose action was based on that, as you all know, and it was on the discoverability of it all. So, yes, of course, as I started, I wanted to talk about this in my speech. Yes, it is important. We want to address this question, favor the discoverability of the Quebec products and the French products, the Francophone products here in Quebec. You know, there's no boundaries unless you put some limitations to that. So we want to prove that we're able to broadcast and have those products are known. Of course, we need some action. And of course, you must understand that the parliamentary regime in which we are, you know, we've try to be quite discreet about that. I don't want to infringe the parliamentary rights to confidentiality, but I assure you that my colleague, Mrs. Hui, and myself will act in that direction. It's a pleasure to hear about that. Can't wait to see the bylaw. The second question regarding regulation, up to what we can go in order to modify regulations. Do you want to couple ticket selling with the Ministry of Revenue, Health, and Education? So, yes, once again, I will remain quite discreet on the legislation and regulation, but let's have a theoretical conversation, Mrs. Poisson. Yes, of course, we could consider that, and I do believe that it could be something very interesting for our cultural industry, as well as for the Quebec government. But as I told you, data is the foundation on which we can sit. Our digital transformation, which is fundamental and extremely necessary, and so is the sharing of the data. It must be accomplished. When we're talking about confidential information, we must also talk about security information in the respect of private life. It is very possible to ensure the protection of personal information and the protection of our citizens and ensure the sharing of data. I believe that it's all about proceeding with an analysis that is exhaustive over the situation. This is what we're doing with the bylaw 64 to review the protection plan for private information and so the study at the parliament, and it is linked between the government of Quebec and different organizations in order to get to what you're offering, Mrs. Poisson. Perhaps the last question. The pandemic had an important impact on all of the artists in the regional areas, and many are complaining about the capacity of the broadband. What happens if they want to share their creation at, in a situation of high-speed internet? So the minister took this question personally. So to make sure that we respected this engagement that we had in order to link everyone at high-speed internet. So today it's an infrastructure that becomes essential if the digital transformation, and that was saying is something that is irreversible through a global movement. Well, what supports that digital transformation is high-speed internet services. So this is why we have agreement signed with communication companies. You also know that the government of Quebec was a partner of the development of Telsat satellites at low altitude, which allows us to have a high-speed internet connection with a performance that is very, very acceptable, comparable to the optic fiber. So for near future in Quebec, these are wonderful news because it will allow us to have a low-altitude satellites, will allow us to have equal connection over all of the territory, which is not always possible when you have the optic fiber because it is expensive, not always viable, seeing the low density of populations. So it is a way to ensure an internet service, and that could be a solution and a response to this issue at the short and medium term. Well, I believe that this will make colleagues, artists, and persons who want to participate in this culture very happy. The question of inclusivity is also all about access to technology. So a And it's true that for large territories like Quebec, we're not served with that fast service everywhere in Quebec. So unfortunately, this is all the time we had. But before I let you go, I would like to send you your best regards of the General Director of Synapses, Diane de Courcy, who's probably listening to us. So thank you very much once again for taking the time to exchange on this file that is a must for the future of culture in Quebec. So thank you very much for a nice invitation and good event to everyone. Thank you. Thank you. So now I'll turn to François-William Croteau, Mayor of Rosemont-la-Petite-Patrie since 2009, since 2017, is a member of the Executive Committee of the City of Montreal, is responsible of Smart City Technology of Information, Innovation, and Higher Education. He also set up at the Laboratory of Urban Innovation of Montreal, which won the challenge for Smart Cities in Canada. Mr. Croteau, the floor is yours. Thank you very much, Mrs. Poisson. Good day, everyone. Thank you for inviting me this morning in order to participate to this important event for the benefit of culture. You know that this is a fundamental element for Montreal, for cities, and for the planet altogether. When we're talking about the use of data, and more specifically nowadays, data that may help us to improve the artistic creation and access to culture in a more global and general way. And I would like to also talk about this morning on two elements which are fundamental for Montreal. First of all, the question of creativity, innovation, and also the question of citizens who have access to knowledge, to culture, social mediation also, which is another important element which underlies several issues to which we're confronted in Montreal, more specifically during the pandemic, that raises issues that were underlying once in order to find a solution to them. So the innovation on and creativity is something fundamental for Montreal, and Montreal must collaborate to this element that are at the heart of artistic creation. Data are more and more used in creativity and innovation. This is why we must give the example and set up a structure, which is a computer structure that gives us access to more data and value data, the capacity to access. And when we work with different partners in the setting in order to establish a collective strategy to access the data. We're talking often of open data, which is always more and more necessary, which is a must also. We must make sure that when we set up a structure of open data, we have to establish structure and parameters for protection in order to prevent that they be used otherwise than established. So it is fundamental. And at the City of Montreal, we've been engaged in a strategy of open data, and we work together with partners in order to share the data with respect to the essential needs of our partners. We did it with the show area in Montreal, and we wanted to increase our knowledge and human movement of all people that wanted to experiment on that area of town in order to improve the experience of the audience and also of the creators outside, you know, that are in constant transformation. In order to get there, we must give each other some barometers in order to protect ourselves under ethical and responsible characters. We have a Montreal chart of digital data, which gives us all of the necessary parameters that correspond to ethics and that are responsible. was so. It was the city of Nantes who had started that, and.
D'une coalition des villes.
It is all about a global city coalition in order to make sure that the use of computer sciences is to the advantage of people who need information if we want to make sure that these data are being well used. So this allows us to work with our partners for the area of shows in Montreal, research centers, and different organizations representing creators that allow us to target properly the data, create data, and render them accessible. So, which leads me in some way to talk about the second theme, the access to data, and to what extent this data can become a fundamental element to the access to culture. Once again, we must know the needs of our citizens and the fundamental access to this culture. When we're talking about all of this, it means that we need to know very well their population and recognize that there is an element that is extraordinarily complicated, which is the digital invoice. So when we're talking about access to culture, we talk often to people who have the means to have a digital access to culture. So immediately we must make sure that this access is essentially also necessary for all of the population, and even more so for the more vulnerable people. We set up at the City of Montreal a strategy to fight against this fracture of digital access and to have a more equal access. And so we're making an effort to turn to more vulnerable parts of our population. And we've won $50 million from the federal government. So this means that we're going to set up a first global data poll on social and demographics data. So this will be made available to all of the actors of our community over all of the territory. It will be open data. All of the partners, cultural, social development, may use this information, and organizations that work in the cultural mediation aspect and give access to people who don't have any access through our municipal infrastructure or any other. So one of the extraordinary things is that we're going to create the first Aboriginal data poll in Montreal. Finally, we will be getting real data on the community living in this territory, helping them and accompany them and work together, of course, which we've started with reconciliation for several years now. It will allow us to accompany the creators and fight against this digital fracture, as I said earlier, that prevents several citizens to access information. Through the pandemic, the fracture actually worsened. And we have data that showed us at the City of Montreal that the places where there are less digital infrastructure and municipal infrastructure, this is where the more vulnerable people live in Montreal. And the highest rates of COVID contamination. So we have to be able to better target where we can intervene with priority and help people. When we're talking about access to culture, we must work with social data in order to better intervene and accompany people helping who needs it more. So we've set up a double strategy, a structure that was set up, essential to the broadcasting of data management and governance. And on the other side, we've set up a structure that allows us a better accessibility, answering to the needs of the most vulnerable citizens. There it is. Thank you very much, Mr. Croteau, for giving us a very ambitious vision for Montreal and for the file on cultural data. Montreal should have a leader place in that area, in collaboration, of course, hopefully, of other major cities. Thank you. Thank you. I also have the pleasure to be the animator of the first panel of the day, which is on audiences of future. The practices of cultural consumption and trends are evolving, bringing the audiences to have different expectations on the content offered. The knowledge that is given by data may help us to direct ourselves in the future changes. Knowing our audience is responding to it, giving a contented response to their own interests. I have three specialists that I'm introducing without delay. Chris Dickinson, who's the general director and head of Téléfilm Canada. She has more than two decades of experience in television, telecom, and interactive and digital media, working at CTV, CPC, at Rogers, and at Interactive Ontario. She has a master's degree in fine arts and film, formed at the Rothman School in Management. So she worked in the management in the broadcasting industry. The second guest, Matt Luck, who founded Star Eatings at, in 2011, directing operations and production projects at the executive level for customers such as BBC, PBS, Foundation, Bill and Melinda Gates, and the Wellcome Trust. So prior to that, he was responsible of innovation at the BBC and the multi-platform at Channel 4. So he launched a public MediaSack project that was launched by him, and he's currently writing a book on the story of metrics, how to measure goals. And the third person is Anna Serrano, president and vice chancellor in Toronto. She was a chief digital officer of the Canadian Film Center, where she implemented a media lab. For several years, she set out strategic functions of the digital area and a creative leader. She received several awards in film industry intermedia, and she also received the medal from France as a title of Chevalier. I have a question for you, Christa. I have one for each one. How do data allow to identify future trends?
Madame Poisson, je suis ravie d'être...
Thank you, Madame Poisson. I'm very happy to be with you. So I will begin in French and then answer to the question in English. Téléfilm Canada is an institution that is really at the heart of the audiovisual industry for now 50 years. So Téléfilm Canada is a federal state company that has as a mandate to foster the development of audiovisual industry in Canada. So we operate in four main fields. First of all, the financial support for development and distribution of Canadian content. And the second piece is really the promotion of talents and Canadian content. Then the management of co-production agreement on behalf of the Canadian government, that's the third axis. And then the programs for funding of Canadian media.
Delve in now the context of who Telefilm Canada is. You know, data collection is very complex, and we dipped our feet into this area several years ago. In 2016, we made a pledge to reach gender parity by 2020. which we did do through our programs. And to do that, it was about starting to collect data, gender-based data, and we do it, you know, around three key creators, producers, directors, and screenwriters. So it started there. And then we moved in 2017. We also looked at how is it that we can start collecting data around Indigenous creators. And this was really as a direct result of conversation, continued work, hand in hand with Indigenous communities. And what we've really seen is in the last year, as we worked actively more towards that, how important this is and how it actually starts forming our decisions on what we're, how we go, we approach our programs. So from an internal perspective, what's the tendency? What's the why? Data is helpful in the sense that it can understand who it is that we are serving, but also more importantly, who's not in that ecosystem. And that really then leads to that evidence-based focus and efforts to, you know, this means improving the management and the administration of the funds itself. So we have, you know, we're in public service and we have a responsibility. It's also about creating an organic and necessary feedback loop with both current past clients and future clients. So it's an opportunity for conversation and to really expand that. And what we're seeing is that the internal research and the results from the data allows us to truthfully modernize the structure of our programs and how we allocate dollars behind such programs. So all of that, of course, is to allow for the success of the clients, the content creators, and the projects. And lastly, really the external perspective. It informs what audiences are also looking for. And that is so important. I mean, you've already touched upon it with the ministers, that the diversity, right? So everybody's talking about EDI. It's not just diversity of audiences, it's diversity of stories that we're seeing. And, you know, how can people want to see themselves reflected in those stories? It's just the way it is, and it's understandable. And having that data allows organizations like Telefilm and other agencies like ourselves to understand audience habits and where people are actually going to view films. So key in all this, discoverability. You know, que ce soit les films québécois, so Quebec films, Canadian films, you know, we've seen them compete with larger Hollywood titles, and they're doing them now in the same spaces. So that means on average, you know, a quarter of Canadians at home viewing time is devoted to Canadian and Quebec content. You know, that probably, for me, that was an aha moment. And we saw this in an audience-based study that we just released last week, done by Léger. And discoverability is so complex today. I mean, how many platforms, Louise, are you subscribed to, right? Quite a few. Mm-hmm. So Telefilm has launched a platform called See It All, en français, Plein la Vue. So I encourage you to go to Telefilm's website and look for See It All or Plein la Vue. We've done it to be able, and we've done it in partnership. So we find that discoverability is all about partnering. So that'd be with Radio-Canada, CBC Gem, Crave, Apple. And it's about making it easier for Canadians to find and, you know, watch their own content. And I do want to say, pour les distributeurs québécois,
and for the Quebec distributors, we also have InfoCinema, which is a wonderful tool, and it's really focused on the French Quebec content. And at this point, Mathieu, who's part of a panel later on this afternoon, may give you more information about how we review our data, how we work with our data. Very interesting. interesting. Thank you, and we'll certainly come back to that. Thank you, Matt.
Pouvez-vous nous parler des changements?
Could you tell us a little bit about the changes that affect the behaviors of audiences from what you've been reviewing, observing?
Yes. I always like, when I think about audience change, I really like to take a long view, because I believe although technology develops quickly, actually audience changes take time. And for me, if we look at the rise of the digital transformation that the minister was talking about earlier on, I think there's really been two really significant groups of skills that we have all learned as audiences over the last kind of 15, 20 years. The first one between about 1996 and about 2006 was about using search. We all learned effectively to be like researchers or librarians. We learned how to type into boxes on the internet and evaluate a series of results that came out to us, and to use that to navigate information. Now, these were skills that really people didn't use outside of kind of research and kind of library studies and knowledge management before the rise of the web. But now that's a skill that pretty much everyone has. And a lot of the products and services that we've taken up as consumers have been built on that bedrock of our ability to search. I think the second skill we've learned as audiences, and this is something that I think Krista was just talking about, really happened from about 2006 to about now. First of all, with the rise of the iPhone and smartphones in general, and more recently, the rise of SVOD services. And that is the ability to be schedulers, to manage our own attention and to make decisions about how and when we were going to use different platforms to engage with media and to engage with stories. Now, I love talking about schedules because the schedule itself is a cultural invention. It was invented in the late 19th century, early 20th century, beginning with telephone broadcast systems, a few kind of maverick ones that opened up in the late 19th century, but then with radio and TV. And scheduling really shaped the public sphere. It shaped the kind of world and how we saw the world in a way which I think is really difficult to kind of overestimate. The fact that most of us were seeing the same thing at the same time had a profound effect on society and culture. And that over the last 10, 15 years has changed. And we are now living in a world that's driven by algorithmic extremes in which we are playing more, we have influence on our own self-scheduling, but also the products that we use are trying to second guess what our experience is, and they're using our data to do that. So we're moving from a world in which the amount of data that was used to make decisions about what programming you saw was absolutely tiny. So I'm currently writing a book about particularly Nielsen and the Nielsen family and their role in kind of inventing the metrics that drove radio and television. And actually, the amount of data that was used to make multi-billion pound commissioning decisions in the media industries in the 20th century was like nothing. It was absolutely tiny. These tiny little samples of audiences, sometimes using things like written diaries to try and work out what people were watching and how they were consuming it. And multi-billion dollar industries were built around these tiny little slivers of data. The last 15 to 20 years, we've seen the amount of data grow. Exponentially isn't even a big enough word to describe it. The amount of data we have about everything that we do online now is the kind of dream of a lot of these pioneers in the 20th century, to be able to track what we do to such a degree and to generate these data and then to analyze that to make commissioning decisions and business decisions was this kind of absolute fantasy in the mid to late 20th century. And that's where we're living in now. So we're in this really interesting time where audiences are scheduling and are in control of a lot more of the behavior, but we are reliant on platforms. And we talked about discoverability. Krista was talking about that just now. The way in which the world is reflected back to us and our ability to make choices is absolutely and critically down to the decisions that are made about the products, the algorithms, and the analysis of our data. So I think as the kind of schedule dominated the 20th century and kind of created the public sphere in many ways through media technology in the 20th century, I think the stream, the algorithmic stream, and the use of data and the tools we are given to manage our own attention will similarly shape the 21st century. And we're really only in the beginning of that. I think we're only really in the first kind of 10, 15 years of seeing what culture is like, where it's based around streams rather than schedules. And actually, those early signs are not good. The kind of politics we're seeing, the kind of public debate we're seeing, it's a very, very different kind of public sphere. And I think it's going to take decades for us to really understand and for us to shape ourselves around that new kind of public sphere. But generally, this change is about audiences shifting their behavior from not necessarily being in control of what they could watch when, to this idea that we are now schedulers, we are managing our own attention. And I think the pandemic has happened just at the time that those behaviors were already starting to become mainstream. So we went through this period in 2006 to 2020, where services were developed that helped us manage our attention, and then we were all sent home for a year. And when we look at the early data coming through, the real winners in terms of media platforms, everyone has seen an uplift in attention. The major broadcasters in the UK have seen increased amounts of TV watching. But it's the SVOD services that have really seen the bump. We've wanted to escape the kind of real world and the news that we were seeing on broadcasters and dive into these incredibly rich kind of narrative spaces on Netflix and Disney Plus and Amazon and things like that. So we're starting to see the kinds of things that people want to watch where they have that choice. And the last year, the year of the pandemic, has given us this extremely odd experiment in accelerating that shift in audience behavior in ways that might otherwise have taken another 5 to 10 years.
Thank you very much. We will certainly come back on these different points, topics. Anna? D'après vous, quels sont les enjeux éthiques?
In your opinion, what are the ethical issues revolving around those changes and the capitalisation on data? Because this will certainly also go back to things that we just heard from Kristan Hamak.
Sorry, the stream is a bit choppy. So Matt really teed this up quite well in terms of the ethical issues, because I don't think Matt meant to say this, but you know, audiences are not kind of just driving the scheduling outside of the context of a technology platform that's driving their behavior towards scheduling, okay? So what that means is that scheduling is not neutral. The action of scheduling is not neutral. The action of scheduling is being primed and pumped by the nature of the media and the technology in which these schedules occur. So algorithmic transparency, algorithmic intentionality, and so on, are going to be the key battlegrounds that I think we will need to approach and enter as we think about the ethical issues as it relates to how audiences get shaped by the technologies that they use, you know? And so that's really the crux. And we're seeing that play out in the antitrust trials that's taking place and the congressional hearings that's taking place with the large platforms of Facebook and Google and so on. And the issue is not necessarily just about privacy. It's really about the control in which these platform, the control these platforms have on the way audiences then the control that they have that essentially shapes the behavior of audiences. So you know, we've read all this time about how you know, as much as it was available to Facebook, they were not willing to really tweak their systems to prevent the extremist polarization that was taking place on their platforms, right? Because the platform, the business model of the platform was predicated on the most clicks, the most attention. And so, and they found that the technology they built amplified a particular kind of set of potentially biological behaviors that people have that allowed attention to be drawn towards the most extreme versions of the news. And so that just exacerbated and amplified and had real consequences that actually had consequences in the material world, so much so that violence would actually happen. So it's not just about an issue of the digital. It's an issue of a set of digital technologies that amplify certain behaviors and certain ways in which audiences are shaped that then could have physical consequences in the real world. That's obviously the extreme. We could argue, well, we're all about TV and movies, and so we're not the news, we're different. Well, I think, you know, we have to learn from what's happening in the media ecosystem and see how we approach that as folks who have some ability to build the social infrastructure, including the funding infrastructure associated with arts and culture. So my last point is really to say, you know what, I think we need to throw away the word discoverability. I talked about this in a meeting that the CRTC ran in 2016, prior to Trump winning the election. They had a summit called the Discoverability Summit, and I believe I was the last speaker of the 3-day summit. And I said, you know, it's time for discoverability to die, because it needs to be all about accountability. So especially as it relates to the public media and to institutions, not-for-profit institutions and universities such as myself, such as the one I run, you know, accountability is all about how do we start to have a sense of intentionality of, and Matt said this beautifully, about the kind of public sphere we want to create. And a public sphere is not about a set of wayfinding signs on where to go. A public sphere is about a set of conditions in which everyone feels safe and able to have access to the same services and uses of space, digital or otherwise, that we're trying to build.
Merci beaucoup, Anna. Est-ce que l'un ou l'autre d'entre vous souhaitez
Thank you, Anna.
Intervenir?
Any of you would like to intervene?
Une question. Sinon, je peux,
on to peut complement parler. One another. Oui. Otherwise, we can carry on with the next question.
Oui. Could I just mentioned, particularly on that last point, there's a really good project called The New Public that's come out of the group Civic Signals in America. And they did a huge piece of research looking at how we have created public spaces in the real world and looked at the kinds of issues that come about genuinely creating good public spaces and applying that into digital. And they've created a kind of framework, an architecture for thinking about creating the kind of digital public spheres that we're discussing today. And I think it's a really, really useful framework. There's a lot of work going on at the moment in lots of different places about how we kind of create healthier digital public spaces. But actually, I think Civic Signals work is really practical. It's a really good framework. It's a great piece of research. And I'd love to see more NGOs, charities, foundations, governments looking at that and thinking about how they can bring that thinking into their digital and media policy.
Yeah, and just as a good example of how such analysis and analogies can work, right? So one of the things that I think we've all talked about, I don't know for how long, 25 years probably, is, you know, the serendipity embedded in physical analog discoverability practices, okay? So before, you would go to a record shop, you'd rummage around things, or you'd go to Stax, or you'd go to a cafe, you'd run into a friend, reading, etc. So there's a kind of built-in sense of serendipitous collisions that can occur in physical spaces. When we look at the media technology platforms that have replaced the way in which we find things, serendipity is not necessarily built into those platforms. In fact, it's erased from those platforms because they're driving towards this kind of notion of predicting what people will want, as opposed to assuming that people may not know what they want, but in colliding with something that they didn't expect, they might like it. So that's a very good example of how, from the outset, the intention of these platforms and the intention of public media and public sphere have been at odds. And so we need to be very mindful of that and start to figure out how to invest in media and technology forms that start to prioritize public service, essentially.
Christa, peut-être que vous auriez quelques mots à dire sur
Christa, maybe a few words to add
film avec
on the links between telefilm and social medias
telefilm gère ou
and how you're
organise
foreseeing or how you're organizing that field, the field of the social media, that is also a little bit in competition with the films themselves.
You know, thinking about what Anna has just said around discoverability, and Anna was there 5 years ago at that discoverability summit, and yes, you know, there's an accountability here, and we're still talking about this. It is about cutting through the noise. So what I find fascinating, and Matt, you say it so well, when you know what an odd experiment COVID is in accelerating everything. I think that what we've realized is, as humans, as industries, we're all able to pivot, and we're seeing these you know, where there's a challenge, there's an opportunity. So from, you know, social media or digital platforms, Louise, it's interesting to see those art houses and independent cinemas. What they've done is they've launched virtual cinema experiences for new releases. So I'm thinking of, you know, at home digital TIFF Bell Lightbox, or over in Vancouver, Van Cities Theater, and where, you know, where once, you know, an indie movie would have thrived in the indie circuit, you know, it's now about this bespoke viewing experience. Canadian titles like Violation or No Ordinary Man have done really well in that. What we're seeing as well is that distributors are starting to rethink how their platforms should be. So it's not just the Warner Brothers or the HBO. So of course, Warner Brothers literally disrupted with the unconventional release of Wonder Woman, right? Totally disrupting discoverability models. But you've also got, just this week, Mongrel Media, homegrown distributor, who just launched Mongrel Home Cinema. And then, you know, when it comes to social media and digital, as far as telefilm is concerned, you know, the difficulty is how do we best deliver on the mandate to make sure that Canadian content is seen at home as well as abroad? How does it shine? And it's an aggregation challenge at the end of the day. So I go back to the solution that I mentioned earlier around the See It All campaign or platform, which is powered in partnership with Just Watch, a stream platform tool. You know, Canadian, the real challenge and why we're putting an effort behind this, and we see that it's a responsibility of telefilms to do so, is that Canadian content simply does not have the marketing dollars to compete with big American releases. And, you know, I think that, you know, just listening to everybody, there is that viewer search fatigue. There's various levels of fatigue in COVID. That's one as well.
Oui, est-ce que quelqu'un d'autre veut intervenir sur...
Well, anybody else? Say something, and this could be controversial, so I apologize. Part of the, you know, I am being slightly, but not that much, facetious by talking about let's throw away discoverability and focus on accountability. But when we think about accountability, right, as a core sort of issue, you know, then the very difficult conversation starts, right? And the difficult conversation, the first difficult conversation is, are we actually investing enough money in arts and culture and in the creative industries to be able to compete in this new environment? And if we want to be accountable to our own arts and culture sector, to our creative industry sector, then that has to be one of the first types of conversations. No amount of aggregation or efforts at making things more discoverable. Well, I'm actually curious. Like, I don't know to what extent such efforts can really compare to just pure investment. Now, I know at the same time that that's a very difficult thing because it's not like, you know, we're now competing with COVID emergency relief and so on, right? But I think it's worth asking that question. I think, Matt, you might have a response to that.
I don't know. And I want to jump in too.
Yeah.
I agree completely. And I think that the real shift in thinking when we think about how we create, you know, better public media spaces is to realize that now we're talking about ecosystems, not products. You know, the people who have really created the vertically integrated stacks of hardware, software, technologies, everything from cloud storage through to devices, through to operating systems, through to app stores, through to monetization and kind of payment systems, et cetera, that we're operating in their world. So when I was at the BBC in the early 2000s running the innovation team, there were a few of us that were thinking that the real question for public media on the internet was that. What does a public media space look like on the internet, on all of it? And we did a whole bunch of research onto things like how we can manage public data. I led a project on how to do personal data ethically for the BBC back in about 2004, 2005. But then we also invented iPlayer, which was our VOD service. And suddenly the rest of the organization were just like, oh, this is what we're going to do. We're going to make TV and we're going to pipe it over the internet. That's a product. Meanwhile, Google and Amazon and Facebook were thinking in terms of ecosystems, like how do we build the entire ecosystem in which the user exists, not just one product? So the public media stack, the project I kind of launched out of StoryThings last year, was an attempt to try and change that. And I think we've got about 10 to 15 years in which we can look at all of the technologies in that stack and not try and build one organization to do it, but to look at how we can make more ethical choices as people producing public media so that when we launch a product, whether it's a VOD project product for films, whether it's a new payment gate for public news sites, whether it's anything that to do with public data, like I'm chair of the audience agency, one of the co-partners here, and we're building platforms that let arts organizations manage audience data in a more ethical way. We should be helping people make ethical choices about their technology so that in 10 to 15 years' time, we are maybe not, you know, 100% reliant on these ecosystems, but there are, at least for some parts of those ecosystems, there are other alternatives which are built and are maintained with a more public-minded ethos rather than just pure commercial exploitation. I think that's going to take at least 10 to 15 years, but we can start now by having that as a goal. What does a public media ecosystem look like rather than what does a public media product look like?
Et je crois, Matt, que ce sera le mot de la fin. Vos échanges,
I think it's going to be the word of the end, and your exchange sharings are very interesting, and I'm very I'm looking forward to the follow-up on your works.
On a besoin de plus de diversité, pas seulement de public.
Clearly, we need more diversity in histories, in type of public audience as well, and we need to broaden up the discoverability for some contents. However, we need to be careful because discoverability sits on an infrastructure that has to be re-questioned, reviewed, and also all the values that come with it. All the values that come with that discoverability that sits right now on an infrastructure that offers more products than content based on responsible values and values that are shared for the largest number of people. So I thank you. It was a very enriching experience and sharing, and I invite you to participate in the rest of the event. You can book a meeting, an encounter on our consultation bar. So next activities, stories about sharing and rethinking the experience of visitors.
Une très belle journée.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.